पर्पल्स ऑफ कम्युनिकेशन एंड वी हैव ऑलरेडी डिस्कस व्हाट इज द प्रोसेस ऑफ कम्युनिकेशन यू नो व्हाट देयर आर सर्टेन कंपोनेंट्स देयर इज एन ऑर्डर व्हिच इज फॉलोड व्हेन वी कम्युनिकेट विद ईच अदर बट देयर आर सर्टेन लेवल्स एज वेल देयर आर लेवल्स ऑन व्हिच वी कम्युनिकेट विद अदर्स और दिस वर्ल्ड ओके देयर आर सर्टेन लेवल्स व्हिच आर इन्वॉल्वड व्हेनेवर अ काइंड ऑफ कम्युनिकेशन इज देयर व्हेनेवर वी आर सेंडिंग द इंफॉर्मेशन और वी आर रिसीविंग द इंफॉर्मेशन दिस इज हैपनिंग ऑन सर्टेन लेवल If we go by the, you know, example which I gave you in the last one, if we go by the example of the process of communication, you can see that there is one sender and a receiver. So that can be called interpersonal because two people are involved in that. Okay. Now we do not know what was the context. Okay, who were those people? What kind of masses they exchanged with each other? So we cannot be sure that whether it was interpersonal only, or it was interpersonal inside an organization, or it was a mass communication. We have no idea. So when we communicate with any other party, generally it is on certain level. Okay, so let's start and learn what are these levels on which we communicate with each other. The first one I'll take in the second place. Well, let's start with this one. This is called interpersonal. As we all know, when there are two or more than two people involved in anything, then it becomes interpersonal. People must have heard about those college meets or college competitions where two or more than two colleges come, and what do we call them? Inter-college competitions. Okay, inter-college debate competition, inter-college sports competition. So the idea is that when there are two people or more than two people involved in something, then it becomes our interpersonal. So here, when in a communication two people are involved, okay, they are communicating with each other, then it becomes our interpersonal communication. What can be the reasons they are getting involved in this kind of communication? They can be from same background, their habits can be same, their educational qualification can be same, and at times we communicate with strangers as well. Although there should be a common reference, there should be a common need to have that communication. And whenever this need, because of this need, we exchange information with the other party, then this becomes our interpersonal communication. This is one of the very important one. Because you know, as professionals, as part of a society, we are supposed to get involved in these kind of scenarios very, very often. And if you ace this particular communication, you get that key to success. Most of the people, they fumble, and you know, they are hesitant when they are in groups, when they are supposed to talk to people of their own age, or you know, people from same background. Even then they feel hesitant because there are certain kind of inhibitions in them. They are of reserved nature, or their communication skills are not good. So here we have to focus on this one. Let's look into the examples. Interpersonal communication is something, you know, which is very, very wide. It's not like in one lecture you can understand it. But when you are sitting in this communication skills workshop, after this one, we'll talk about listening skills. Then we have feedback, how to give feedback. Then there are interviews, how to take part in them. This is an umbrella term. Interpersonal communication is an umbrella term. There are so many skills which are covered under it. And if you want to ace this one, if you want to get to become an expert in this one, you should keep improving yourself. Read a lot, listen a lot, and communicate a lot. Those conversations, they cannot be called, you know, your interpersonal skills, which you generally, you know, that chatting which you do with your friends. But yes, you know, when we are in a serious conversation with someone. It's just like if you form a group among your friends, okay, there are 4 to 5 students, you find a relevant topic and then you discuss about it. Any current topic which is in news and you discuss it and you give your critical comments on that, that is also your interpersonal communication. It is going to help you. Okay, so let's look into the examples here. The first example is when you are talking to your friends. Second is a teacher and a student discussing an assignment. Third is a patient and a doctor discussing a treatment. A manager and a potential employee during an interview. You can see we have taken examples. I have taken examples from all the parts of life. It can be a casual one where you are talking to your friend. It can be an academic one where you are talking to your teacher. It can be a social one where you are supposed to discuss things with your doctor. It can be a professional one where you have to communicate with your boss or a manager. Okay, so this interpersonal communication, this is present everywhere. This is the most important level where you need to focus, okay? Although organizational is also there, but organizational is also built upon this interpersonal, okay? So let's look into the other one. Is this clear to you, is this one? Because this is very, very popular, very, very common.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. At any stage, if you feel any problem, you can ask me, no problem. Now we come to intrapersonal. Have you heard the term intra before?
Yes, ma'am.
What do you mean by intra?
Intra is something like within.
Very good, Gauja. Whenever something happens inside, okay, so when we say intrapersonal, personal means on the person level, on the level of a person. So intrapersonal means within a person. Okay, if we elaborate this term intra, you can take the example of internet these days. When we talk about internet, it means all over the web. Okay, all over the web. But when we say intranet, it means inside some organization where only the people of that particular organization can communicate with the help of that internet, or they can take information or send information. Then that becomes intranet. So in the same manner, intrapersonal communication is whenever you communicate within yourself. Okay, this is not you are talking to someone else, you are talking to yourself. This happens, every day you take several decisions, and when you are taking those decisions, then this sending and receiving is happening. If we try to find out two parties here, it will be very, very difficult. But it's not like, it's impossible. You can see that, we have one heart and one brain. Certain times we go by our emotions, certain times we go by our reasons. And most of the times when there are things very, very difficult, what happens? There is a tussle between our emotions and our reasoning. And most of the time, if you are a person who is very practical, your brain will win. Okay, so you will go by the reasoning. But if you are a bit of those people or you have the personality of those people who are a bit emotional, you will go by what your heart is asking you to do. So here what we are trying to say that intrapersonal means you, when you communicate to yourself, even meditation is a kind of communication, because you try to find out the core, okay, your internal core. You are trying to focus on yourself. There again a kind of communication is there. Okay, so this self-talk or inner speech or mental conversation which we carry within ourselves, this is called intrapersonal communication. And this is very important. If you do not listen to your reason again and again, you start missing most of the things in life. You will remain confused. This is why, that when you have to take very big decision, you always take time. Okay, certain times we discuss it with others. We take help from supervisors, counselors, parents, friends. But most of the times, what do? We sit alone, we think over it, and we try to find out a solution, and then we take decision. So this intrapersonal communication is again very, very important. What can be the examples? The first one is, you know, when you make any kind of decision from what to eat or where to take, you know, which kind of job you should apply for, whether you should, you know, relocate yourself, whether you should go for an exam or not, okay, whether you should get the, you know, whether you should refuse an offer or whether you should accept that. When you think and about something, what you want to do on the weekend, or when you think about another person, all these things are where you have to make small to big decisions. And for this purpose, we use our self-talk. Okay, we have a kind of mental conversation with ourselves, and then we take the decision. There is a very popular joke. You know, people say, "Of course, I talk to myself. I need expert advice." Have you heard this one?
Yes, ma'am.
And that is true. That is true. Although when if you are if you keep this habit under control, it's very easy. But if you, you know, if you let it go out of your hands, then it becomes very, very difficult for you, know. Then people find you talking to yourself, and that is something which is not good. So again, interpersonal communication is important, but we need to be conscious about that. Okay, so interpersonal. Now we come to organizational. This one is, you know, when people communicate within an organization. Just like when we say that human beings are social animal, they live in a society and they have to communicate with each other. In the same manner, when they work inside an organization, these organization also run on the basis of communication. There are teams, there are team leaders, there are people who are working together, and they have to communicate with each other to get things done. They know what are the, you know, what are these aims of the organization, what is the mission of that organization, and to achieve that, what happens, to achieve that aim, they communicate on daily basis. Although there are separate categories in which we can divide this communication, in which these people get involved. First one is internal operational. We all know that there are certain business which happen or which takes place inside the organization. It's just like when you are having a meeting, a project meeting, where you are giving the report how well you did in an examination. So sorry, not examination, in a project. So you give the report to your immediate boss, or there can be MD of that company. These presentations, these meetings, these appraisals, all these they are executed at the level of internal operational. It means only people who work in that organization, they are involved in this communication. Only those people who work there, then it is internal operational. But there are times when information comes from outside. It is just like yours is a company in construction business. Now, if you are constructing something, you will construct it for others. You are not going to build everything for yourself. So you will be in business with other organizations, other small or big firms. So whenever you receive information from there, comes to your, comes to your organization, it is incoming information from external sources. And if you send information from your side to other organization, which is not the part of your organization, then again it is external. This time it is going out, okay? this is an outgoing call, as we understand in telephone. Incoming or outgoing, in both the cases this is external, because people from other organization are also involved in this kind of communication. Finally, we have personal communication. We studied grapevine. Do you remember? Okay, we have not reached grapevine. Grapevine is in the other next, in the next topic. So what happens when people who work under one roof from morning to evening, it's not like they are connected to each other only for because of their work. We did in the interpersonal communication, we are in constant need of sharing information. This information can be personal as well. So people who are working with you, you communicate with them, you a kind of rapport is established. People get friendly with each other and they share other information as well. Certain times these personal conversation, the reason behind them is official. People from organization are communicating with each other. It can be, the basis can be something which has happened in the organization, but it cannot be directly related to work. It is not happening because you are working there. It may be a kind of rumor, it can be a kind of gossip, and then this becomes our personal communication, okay? Because it is not contributing in the organization in any way.
Ma'am, like we can say a casual talk between the employees.
Yes, that is correct. There are even columns where people talk about your coffee machine conversation. That is a very common term, coffee machine. People take coffee breaks and there they meet and they gossip about all the things. Okay, so they cannot be categorized as something organizational. It is not contributing there, but it gives vent to their feelings. When you feel very frustrated, especially about a colleague or a boss. So if you talk about, about this with other of the employees, it gives a kind of pain to your suppressed emotions. So that is very, very common. I guess this one is also clear, organizational.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, Gauja. Other students, are you sleeping there? No one is replying. Why?
We understood, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. It's clear.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. So now we are moving to the next one, which is mass communication. Do you know the term mass communication? What are the things which fall under this one? Although it is written there, but even then, please tell me what is mass communication. What are the media? Yes, Rajdeep.
Ma'am, mass communication is a way to communicate with a larger number of people directly. For example, the news in the television, the anchor can tell the news to the whole nation.
Yes, correct. Rajdeep has given the correct answer here. The reach is mass. Okay, the people who by mass we means in crowd, in big number, in large number. So mass communication is the electronic or print transmission of messages to the general public. As I told you, when we get involved in interpersonal communication, what happens? People have some kind of same background or, same reference of communication. And when we are in organizational, they are, they know each other because they work in the same place. Okay, so again, they share a kind of same background. But in mass communication, nothing of that kind happens. People, they are from the general public. There's no relation between them. They are not connected to each other. They do not share any kind of background with each other. Here, this public can be from anywhere. Okay, these people who are being aimed at, they are from different background, different age group, different, you know, from the different part of the country. They have no similar background. That is the biggest thing. And second one is the reach. The reach is very, very large. People, a large number of people can be aimed or can be communicated with at the same time. Okay. Although they are not present in the same place, even then they receive the same kind of message. So how does this happen? Because this is generally done through electronic or print transmission. When we say electronic, we are talking about, you know, radio, television, film. And when we talk about printed, we are talking about newspaper, magazines, and these days on social media, although social media falls in the category of electronic media only, because we need devices for that. So again, what happens because of these, with this media, with the help of this media, an information is put there. With the help of those satellites, they are sent through the electronic transmission, and all over the world, you know, what happens, this information is shared. Give me a minute, excuse me for a minute, just a minute. Sorry for that. Okay, so what happens here? You can look at the examples here. A television commercial, a magazine article, hearing a song on the radio, books, newspaper, billboards. Billboards are, do you know what is billboard? What is a billboard? No one? You see those big banners outside, you know, those wooden frames are there and big posters are pasted all over the city when any new product is launched. These days even, you know, cereals, for movies, those big billboards are put there. They put big banners there. They are called billboards. Yes, yes. What are you saying?
Hoarding,
yes, hoardings are billboards. Main thing is they are big posters, big banners, and through that information is being shared. The key is that you are reaching a large amount of people without it being face to face. And feedback is generally relayed with mass communication. If I tell you that, you know, very often this happens, you know, these days when we go for shopping, they ask for our telephone numbers. Okay, they generally, when they generate that bill, purchase bill, they ask for our phone numbers, and then they start, you know, sending those unsolicited messages. This sale is on, that sale is on. So they are, what are they doing? They just put one message there and it is delivered to several phone numbers. Okay, so this is also a kind of mass media. Is it true?
Yes, ma'am.
This is the commercial, a way of commercial, you know, where they are, they have an offer and they send it to directly to the numbers. So what happens? How are they going to get the feedback here? They have a sale. Okay, they have a sale where they are selling things on 50% discount. Now it is sent to 1,000 people. Okay, 1,000 people have received the message. Now how are they going to get the feedback that message has been received? Any idea?
When the selling will increase.
Yes, when the sale will increase, it will be a kind of message. And you know, when generally they announce the sale, they announce the date. So on that date, if the footfall is good, several people, you know, turn up there for this purchasing or shopping, then the feedback is received by them. So here it is generally delayed, although we cannot say that it is missing, but in certain places it can be missing. Like we listen to so many news, so many pieces of news every day is, you know, are circulated on daily basis. Do we react to all of those? that never happens. Although if we talk about Twitter, what is happening on Twitter, so yes, there can be reactions. They call them Twitterati. Okay, so people from, you know, Twitterati, they go there and they react on those news. But that doesn't happen in all the cases. Even in, you know, on television, we watch so many piece of information, but we do not react to all of them. When we talk about this, you know, mass media, there is a presence of a gatekeeper generally. When we put any information there and it is transmitted to a large group, there is need for someone who can restrict it, who can, you know, in a manner, who can scan, scrutinize whether the message is fit to be displayed or fit to be transmitted or not. Okay, so there is always a presence of gatekeeper when we are in mass communication. Can you tell me, if I talk about newspaper, do you know who is the gatekeeper there in newspaper, when newspaper is printed? Do you have any idea who is the person who scrutinizes the news? Okay, movies. When there are movies, any movie releases, before that, you know, there is an authority who checks the fitness of, you know, whether controversial scenes are not there, whether there are things which do, you know, controversial things which can offend a particular group or, you know, particular community. So these kind of things are checked before releasing the movies, before release of the movies. So which is the authority which does this?
Ma'am, for movies, maybe it is CBFC.
CBFC.
What CBFC. CBFC, Central Board of Film Certification. Yes. Which actually censors the scenes.
Yes.
According to
it is also called Censor Board.
Yeah.
Neha, can you spell the Censor Board?
CENSOR.
Yes, correct. Okay, so this one is not that sensor which we use in machines. This is CENSOR, sensor board. You know, certain times we come across this news that they chopped off a whole scene from a movie, or they asked them to change the title of the movie because they found that it was not fit for the society. There can be ruckus, it can create ruckus there, out there. So they asked them to remove the titles there. Okay, so now tell me, when we talk about newspaper, who is the gatekeeper there?
Ma'am, can journalists be?
No, journalists are the people who bring the news, okay, or who contribute the news. They prepare the stories there, but they are not the gatekeeper. No one knows. This is a very common one. Editors.
I'm editor.
Editor, yes. I gave you a lot of time, but you people did not respond. Okay, editors, when we talk about magazines, newspapers, and even books, here the person who is responsible for this is called an editor. It's editor's responsibility to check whether the news is fit to be circulated or not. Okay, so this was our mass communication when we talk to people on a large level. Finally, this is extra personal. This is not related directly to the organizational or professional, but this is also one part of our communication levels. So we should know this one as well. Extra personal is where one party is human and the other party is non-human. Okay, so when human beings communicate with non-human entities, when I say non-human, it doesn't mean non-living. Non-human and non-living are different. You cannot communicate. Yes, Bharat.
Ma'am, sorry to interrupt. Ma'am, when motivational speakers talk to people, is that again a mass communication?
It depends. If this is face-to-face, this can be interpersonal. And if there is a large group where they take the help of mic and loudspeaker, and then, you know, a large group is being addressed, that will be mass communication.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, so here we are talking about extra personal. I was telling you that non-human and non-living are very different. Non-living doesn't breathe. They do not have any, you know, any kind of breathing system, or, you know, they don't have brains, any of the qualities of a living being. So non-human are those who do not who cannot be called human, but they are living beings. So generally animals and, you know, birds, they fall in this category. So whenever people communicate with their dogs and pets, then it becomes extra personal communication. Yes, Aditi.
What about when we communicate with the AI assistant?
AI?
AI assistant like Siri and all.
Yeah, Alexa and all. That is, you know, that is not extra personal, because that is a machine and it is working according to the, you know, feeded instructions there. So that it cannot be called extra personal, and that is not all in any of this, that cannot be in any category. Because, you know, after some time, if you start communicating with them, and after some time you start talking difficult things to them, they just simply search the internet and they bring out the information from there. That happens, Aditi? Is it true?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
So they do not have their brain, they do not have their reasoning, they are wired like that. So that cannot be called extra personal communication.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. So, you know, when you return from your office and you come back and your dog is wagging its tail all around you, what kind of message he is giving to you, or it is giving to you there?
Ma'am, it's missing the owner.
Yes, throughout the day he missed you, and now he is happy that you are back. So with the wagging of its tail, you can see that he is happy. Certain times when they keep barking again and again, you know, they show their aggression there. They express their feelings, and if you are, you know, if you are focused enough, or if you are familiar with them, you can understand without speech what emotions they are going through. Okay, although there is limit to that, but even then, if you have pets, you can communicate with them, and that is what we call extra personal communication. Okay, so these were the five important levels on which we communicate with other people. There is a kind of communication which is generally not taught, and I don't think all of you will believe it, but this is a popular one when we communicate with spirits, you know, ghosts or spirits. Do you know what do we call them, that kind of communication? What is the name of that communication where you talk to spirits? Some kind of cult is involved.
Occult?
No, occult means, you know, something which is not normal, related to dark spirits and all. That is paranormal, you know. But what do we call this communication when you communicate with spirits? That is called transpersonal. Okay, that is generally called trans. Trans means across. So when you talk to spirits which are beyond, in the other world, across the world, then it becomes transpersonal communication. Okay, so I guess this one is clear. Levels of communication.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so let's move to the next topic. Because we meet only once in a week, it's a bit difficult. Every time I forget where we were. But today I am, you know, trying to finish this one, the flow of communication. When we talked about organizational communication, and, you know, in organizational communication, we talked about internal operational. This is where we, you know, this is how we communicate inside an organization. This is generally called the information flow. Okay, how the information flows inside an organization. So So there are four types or the four, you know, four, we cannot say levels because levels we have just discussed. But in a way, this is the direction in which generally information flows. Okay. And this is why they have named it downward, upward, horizontal and diagonal. In these directions, communication flows. Let's look into the chart first and then we'll look into the definition. So it will be a bit easier for you to understand. You can see in this chart, we have three hierarchical levels. Do you have any idea what is hierarchy? What do you understand by the term hierarchy?
Ma'am, we can say it as different levels where one is above the other.
Yeah. So in a simple way, we will call it ranks. Okay, according to the ranks. So these are, if you look into this picture, you can see there are three ranks involved here. First one is managing director, and there is only one managing director. It means the top management, the person who is, who is in control of the whole organization. On the second level, we have directors. So we have named them 1, 2, 3. You can name them according to, you know, director of production, director of supply, director of finance. So you can do that as well. Then under each director, we have three managers. Okay. So you can see we have taken three ranks here. Three hierarchical positions are involved. So when, you know, there is any information which is going from manager to managing director, then it becomes upward. When any information flows from managing director to manager, then it becomes downward. And when people of same rank communicate with each other, then it becomes our lateral or horizontal. And if people from different departments communicate with each other, then it becomes diagonal. Okay. I have shown you this picture so that when I explain the definition, you can be, you know, you can understand that easily. Let's look into the directions here. First one is downward information flow. It is, you know, it occurs when the person in top management and leadership positions shares the instructions with employees working in the lower levels. Every day there are several reports, there are several instructions which are, you know, sent to the employees in the lower level. Okay. The most important purpose of this downward information flow is to share the instruction, to give the instruction, to tell the people who are working in the lower position that how they are supposed to carry out their jobs, what should be their vision there, okay, what should be the expectation, okay, or what should be the outcome of that particular exercise they are doing there, okay, so in downward information flow, it starts from the top management and it reaches the lowest level of the, not always the lowest level, it can be, you know, for certain people and it cannot be for certain people, but it comes from the upper side and it goes to the lower side. So when communication, when information flows from the upside to the downside, it is called downward information flow. Again, in the same manner, as you know, instructions were given, mission and vision were shared, in the same manner, there are feedback, okay, whatever instructions they received, but in whatever way people followed those instructions, they carried out their jobs, now there is a feedback. So when this feedback in kind of reports, in kind of, you know, complaints, whenever this starts from the lower side and it is sent to the upper side, then it becomes our upward information flow. Look into the definition. Communication of information flows from the downward to the upward direction, such as from the lower level employees to the higher level employees. Okay. We'll look into these flow in, you know, in detail. We'll discuss the limitations and purpose as well. But for introduction, let's look into the definitions only. Now we have horizontal information flow. exchange of information across various departments of the business that exist at the same level. As we saw that directors, there were three directors or there were several managers. So if they communicate among each other, you know, with each other, where only directors are communicating with each other or only managers are communicating with each other, then it will become horizontal because people from the same level are communicating with each other. And these are not the people from a different hierarchy. They are from the same level. And it is generally said that this is the most difficult level of communication because all the people enjoy the same kind of power. Okay, they are on the same level, so they think they have the same kind of power, and no one is ready to, you know, no one is ready to give up in front of each other. They do not generally withdraw themselves from the tussles. So most of the time it is the most difficult one because people enjoy the same kind of position. Finally, we have diagonal information flow. So what happens in diagonal information flow? It takes place when there is a cross-functional communication between staffs working at different organizational levels. We have seen, you know, in downward and in upward, there are chains, there are people involved, there are mediators. First, the manager will send the information to the manager, director. From director, it will reach the managing director. So what happened? It will take two turns in reaching it to the MD. And in the same manner, here we have taken only three levels. Generally, the levels are, you know, very complex. In most of the time, many hierarchical levels are involved inside an organization. It is not like only three levels of ranks are involved. There are number of ranks involved. And it wastes a lot of time. It wastes a lot of time when people try to communicate with each other. So as a remedy, what happens? People prefer to communicate directly with each other. It's very, very common, you know, or it's very feasible that if MD has something to talk to one of the manager, he can directly call that manager. Or, you know, if that manager has something to, you know, communicate with the MD, he can approach them. Although this is, you know, generally if people, let's look into the picture, it will be a bit clear, you know. This, you can see manager 3 is directly talking to director 2. There is a diagonal arrow here. He is talking to director 2. Although it's not possible every time for the manager to reach the managing director directly. But even then, here what has happened? If this was upward communication, manager 3 was supposed to send the information to director 1. From director 1, it should reach director 2. This is proper following of the channel. And when the manager doesn't do this, doesn't follow this, this is called bypassing the channel. Okay, but in some of the organization, people entertain or welcome this kind of communication. It is called diagonal. It is also called open door policy. They say that they have opened their doors for everyone. Anyone can walk up to anyone and they can communicate with each other. Okay, so when this kind of communication takes place, this is called diagonal. And it generally happens in flat organization where people do not follow too many, you know, ranks or too many levels of hierarchy. When they prefer a flatter organization, most of the people are on the same position and they enjoy the same kind of, when they enjoy the same kind of position, they can communicate with each other. Okay, so in these kind of organization, people can walk up to anyone and they can communicate with each other. So these are the four directions in which, you know, generally our information flows. And if any of the hierarchical level are, you know, jumped or ignored, then it becomes bypassing of the channel. So is there any question from this one?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
Okay, if anyone has any question from these four, you can ask me. Otherwise, I'll tell you about the one more topic is there, which is attached to this one. When we talked about this one, I told you that this is from organizational, okay, in internal organizational communication. This is also called formal flow of communication. By formal, which we, what do we mean? When we say formal, what is the meaning of formal? Anyone? When you talk about, you know, your dress code, you ask each other formal or informal. So what is formal there? Formals, what do we mean by formals? You generally
code in which certain set of rules have been set in.
By? These rules are set by
the head of the organization.
Yes, Ishita, correct. So whenever there is a, you know, set rule or regulation or the rules laid down by the organization, they are called formals. If there is a dress code for you people, a uniform, that will be your formals. And if you do not follow that, you wear a casual dress there, that becomes informal. So in the same manner, when we say formal flow of communication, when we say formal flow of communication, these directions or these hierarchical levels, these levels are set down by the organizations. This is how generally people can communicate. There will be no bypassing, and this is accepted by the management. Then it becomes our formal flow of communication. But inside every organization, there is existence of informal communication as well. As we discussed that it was personal. This is in organizational language, in business language, it is generally called grapevine. Grapevine is the informal flow of communication. It exists inside every organization. You know what is a grapevine? You must have heard about this creeper, you know, grapes. The fruit grape, so it's vine, it's creeper. If you throw it on any roof or in any field, it just grows in every direction. There is no fixed direction in which it will grow. Okay, so in the same manner, when any rumor, any piece of, you know, any gossip, when it enters the grapevine, it flows in every direction. Okay, and this exists in all the organization because people from different hierarchy are unofficially related to each other. They can be friends, they can be neighbors, they can be, you know, siblings who are working inside one organization. They can belong to different hierarchical levels, but even then they communicate with each other. And through this, you know, certain information travels. Certain information travels through this grapevine. And as it happens, you know, whenever there are holidays in a college, so before the holidays, you come to know about the dates of the holidays. When there are UTs, when there are midterms, you come to know about the date before the official announcement. How does this happen? This comes through the grapevine, you know, through rumors, through gossip. And no one knows from where this originated. There is no fixed point. Anyone can tell that, you know, this particular person is responsible. It just spreads in every direction and all of us act in spreading that. Okay. And it is generally said that managers who are skillful, they are able to use it for their own benefit when, you know, they know. Who are the people through whom he can send certain information outside. It's just like a new policy is being implemented. They know that people are going to oppose that policy. So what do? They put it in grapevine before implementing it through the, you know, with the help of this grapevine, it spreads everywhere. People talk about it. And after some time, people just, you know, get mentally ready to accept it. And then this is implemented. So before the real implementation, what did that manager do? He prepared the mindset with the help of Grapevine. So this Grapevine is present everywhere. There's no organization which can, you know, save itself from these informal flow of communication. And generally, generally managers use it very tactfully, but yes, certain times it goes out of hands and then it creates a lot of havoc there. So this is you know, our organizational communication, where we have discussed formal and informal flow of communication. Okay, so now if you have any query, please ask. From levels to flow, everything. Okay, I guess there is no problem. So shall I end it here?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.